Is the screen visible for you?
Wait, sir. Just I'm streaming it on YouTube, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Screen is visible.
Okay.
Very good afternoon to one and all. I welcome all the delegates and speaker for today's webinar, Pratignya 2020. Myself, Dr. Sarita, and our today's speaker is Dr. Prasanna Keshava, sir. Sir has completed UG from Alvas Ayurveda Medical College, Modabidri, and obtained Komaravritya PG from Government Ayurveda College, Thiruvananthapuram. Sir is presently working as Associate Professor in the Department of Komaravritya at Karnataka Ayurveda Medical College, Mangaluru. Sir is also obtained DYN from Alvas Yoga and Naturopathy College, Modabidri. Sir is a consultant in Samhita and Sudharma Ayurvedic Centers. Sir has conducted many camps for school-going children, and sir has attained more than 20 seminars, workshop, and CME, and presented many papers in the national and international level seminars. And sir has published 4 articles in national and international journals. Sir is also contributed 1 chapter on research methodology, and sir is one among the editors of the Android app publisher and founder member and tutor for online class of Laksha Ayurveda Academy. And sir has completed pediatric emergency medical course from KIMS Thiruvananthapuram 2012. Sir was also an executive editor for Saishavam e journal 2010-2012, and sir has also organized many seminars, and sir is given a guest lecturer in many health sectors. Today, sir is going to deliver a session on Shayamutra, autism, Unmada, and ADHD. Now I'll hand over the session to sir. Sir, over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Thank you. At first, myself, Dr. Prasanna Keshava from the Komaravritya Department of Karnataka Ayurveda Medical College. Thank Dr. Sarita, ma'am, and Principal Prashant, sir, for the extended invitation to speak on the national level webinar series, which is exclusively carried over by RGHS. So today I'll be talking on Shayamutra, autism, and ADHD. And the main objective of my presentation is to give an outline which is specifically exam oriented and for the third year UG students. So I'll 40 minutes has been given to me, and I'll try to finish it off within those time. And I'm planning to cover these 3 topics: Shayamutra, autism, and ADHD. I hope all these topics have been already covered to you. So I'll be going on a bit faster so that it will be a revision for you. First topic is about the Shayamutra, or which we usually call as the bedwetting, or also medically called as nocturnal enuresis. So enuresis is nothing but it is the persistent wetting beyond an age at which normal control is expected to have been achieved. Okay, especially the toilet control we're talking about. And this enuresis is very much common in boys and may have a positive family history also. So whenever we take the history, family history, we'll find that their parents or their siblings, okay, would have had that history. And the definition is repeated voiding of urine into clothes or bed at least twice a week for at least 3 consecutive months in a child who is at least 5 years of age. So that is a bit important. That means the child's age should be above 5 years or equal to 5 years. Okay. So that is a maximum time where we are expecting him to have a toilet control. Okay. And the history should be like there is a repeated voiding of the urine, not a single one time he has soiled the clothes at night. So that is not the definition. Okay. So repeated voiding of urine into the clothes or bed at least twice a week for at least for a 3 consecutive months. So that is very, very important. Okay. So when we talk about the enuresis, there is a 2 terminologies. One is diurnal enuresis and other one is nocturnal enuresis. Diurnal enuresis defines wetting when awake also. Nocturnal refers to the voiding during sleep. Classification is based on achievement of control. That is when exactly he had this history of enuresis has been started. So whether he has attained toilet control or not. So if he has attained this bladder control especially, then after some time, at least for 6 months, he has a good bladder control. And after that, he started with not becoming dry. Then we will call it as the secondary enuresis. And till now, that is his age is above 5 years, and till now, he is not at all attained any bladder control. Okay, so for that, we will call as the primary enuresis. That is when a child has never achieved bladder control, who never been dry throughout the night. Okay, secondary enuresis, when the child was dry for at least 6 months and started wetting again. And based on the time of the day, we have got something called as nocturnal, which is very much common in 80%, and diurnal, we'll find 5%, and both 15%. So these two are the classification. And when we think about the physiology of bladder control, there are several conditions that must be present. So first is about the awareness of the bladder filling. Second is cortical inhibition of reflex bladder contractions. And third is about the ability to consciously tighten the external sphincter to prevent incontinence and normal bladder growth, that is anatomical, and the motivation by the child to stay dry. So that's also very important. Okay. And these girls typically acquire bladder control before boys, and bowel control typically achieved before bladder control. So that is also very important. So when you take the history, whether she or he had a bowel control or not, okay, whether he is lacking. Okay. So when we talk about the etiology, there will be likely involvement of the etiologies from the biological sector, then emotional factors and learning factors. So these three are also very important. Okay, so we will see one by one. See the causes for primary enuresis, which I was talking about. There are classification for primary and secondary. So for the primary is organic causes. Under the organic causes, bladder neck obstruction, ectopic urethral opening. Okay, then epispadiasis, sacral agenesis, meningomyelocele, lipoma of cauda equina, rarely some of the conditions like hydrocephalus, diabetes mellitus, and diabetes insipidus. Okay, so these are the different organic causes for the primary enuresis. And the non-organic causes are improper bladder training. So this is very, very important. So major of the times we will find that the improper bladder training is the major of the cause for this type of nocturnal enuresis. Then developmental or neuromaturation delay. So like the conditions like cerebral palsy or such other things. Small bladder capacity. Okay. Then some of the genetic factors. Then the sleep disorders. So they also can be found. Causes for the secondary enuresis. That is, he has attained a dry at night for around 6 months, and later he or she has developed enuresis. So that are recent stressful events, urinary tract infections, pinworm infestation. So even though we think that there are no worm infestations, practically in different areas or in different areas where we practice, we'll find that in certain communities or based on their living standards, etc., this pinworm infestation is very much common. So that history also should be taken. Then constipation, endocrinal disorders like diabetes mellitus, diabetes insipidus, nighttime seizures, and lesions of the lumbosacral spine. So when we have identified, so what will be the treatment plan for this? So the possibility of a steady progression in the spontaneous remission rate of the enuresis is to be kept in mind. So if you give a treatment for say 1 month or 15 days and it became dry, and there is a possibility of a remission also. So that also you should be explained to the parents. Okay, then if at all there is a family conflict, parent-child antagonism and or peer teasing, this is very important. Say elder brother is there or sister is there, So they tease this particular child for becoming wet at night due to enuresis are good reasons to institute treatment for enuresis with resultant beneficial effects on a child's well-being and self-esteem. Okay, so these are also to be kept in mind and should be ruled out and should be kept in mind when we think about the treatment. Okay, so the management mainly focuses on identifying the stress factors and take remedial measures. Counseling, that is parent and child education, both are important. Okay, and charting with rewards for dry nights. So you can take a sheet of paper or a book and which all day he was dry. So you give some his items as rewards. Okay, small item would be also sufficient. So that will give sufficient motivation for the child. Voiding before bedtime, that is very, very crucial. Okay, so before going to bed, you can go to once to pass urine and then make him go to sleep. Night awakening in 2 to 4 hours before bedtime. So there is a small mistake. So what you can do is that when he goes for sleep, then within 2 hours or 1.5 hours, the first round of urine passing can be done. Okay, so that usually we will call as the alarm method. Okay, and one more alarm is available. That is alarms that respond to moisture. So whenever the child wets the bed, so this alarm rings. Okay, so both technique can be adopted, and withholds fluid at night. So once he passes the urine, so in the beginning of the bladder control, what you can do is that so within next 2 hours, again the parents has to keep the alarm and then get up and make the child pass urine. Okay, so that we usually call as the bladder training. If you find that the child is having a smaller bladder capacity, then of course you can reduce the timing also. Okay, and make it a shorter duration. Okay, and you can advise some bladder stretching exercises and conditioning. Okay, so apart from this, even the child can be encouraged to avoid holding urine and to void frequently during day, not at night. Okay, so that will also will help in to avoid this day wetting. Okay, if at all the child is having diurnal, then furthermore, if constipation or fecal impaction is also associated, so they are the problems, then children should be encouraged to have a daily bowel, there is a small mistake, bowel movements, and taught optimal relaxation of the pelvic floor muscles to improve the bowel emptying. That's also important. So you can give this constipation decreasing type of kind of or the medicines which will help in smooth bowel evacuation. And at last, we have got something called as the pharmacotherapy. From the allopathy system of medicine, they have got desmopressin acetate along with ADH, that is the antidiuretic hormone, vasopressin, which decreases the nighttime urine production. And one more drug that is called as imipramine. So that's also 50% useful. Then oxybutynin and tolterodine. That will help to increase the bladder capacity. So depending on the particular condition or depending on the history, you have to go for the treatment. Okay. So coming from the Ayurvedic side, in Ayurveda, we call it as the Shayamudra, and the specific reference we will find in Vaishyaratnavali. Okay. So any condition which hinders the pakvata of the dhatus, that can lead to this condition. Okay. So the dhatu pakvata doesn't happen. So the pathogenesis lies in the defective functioning of the apana vayu, which controls the evacuation of the urine and stools. I hope you remember the shloka from Ashtanga Hridaya, where apana vata is having this particular function. Okay. And any disturbance in the functioning of the vata dosha as such. And secondary to manovikaras, pakvasha vikaras, or vasti vikaras also, can be said or can lead to this kind of disease, Shayamudra. The treatment mainly based on, say, if at all you find that there is a manovikara, or since these topics is related with a behavioral manifestation, behavioral disorders being classified as, so the medial line of management always works, okay, major of the times. Like you can advise this Kalyanakrita or Mahakalyanakrita. So that's very, very, very useful. Or these patent syrups are available, like mentad syrup or even tablets also will help, which will having this media type of medicines. Haridra, Shunti Pakva Jala for drinking, Then Brahmana line of management, Vatanuloma. So it will rule out these constipation and other things. Then Apanavata also, it will have a good outcome. Then Krimihara. So if at all you find that there is a worm infestation, Krimihara line of management will help. And administration of Bimbi Mula Swarasa is specifically mentioned by Vaisharatnavali. That is Bimbi Mula Rasapanat Shaya Mutram Pranashyati. So that will be useful. So that's about the Shaya Mutra. So I hope I am not very fast. So is this speed is enough, ma'am?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So the moving on to the next disease, that is autism spectrum disorders, which we call as the ASD. So I hope you remember about this film. Maybe you would have seen. My name is Khan and I am not terrestrial. Okay. So in this, you can find that the hero is suffering from a condition called as Asperger syndrome, which is a variant of autism. Okay. It's coming under the broad heading ASD. So what it actually mean by ASD is a spectrum of psychological conditions characterized by widespread abnormalities of social interaction and communication. So that's very important, social interaction and communication, as well as severely restricted interest. So he will have a restriction in the interest which he will show, and highly repetitive behavior. So these three are the basic pillars of ASD, you can say. Okay. So the epidemiology, that is the prevalence of autism, is 1 to 2 per 1,000 people, but is gradually becoming increased. And that is the number of people diagnosed with autism has increased significantly. So whether it's because of the actual number of increase of autism, or is it because of the actual prevalence has increased, or because of whether the, what we say, increased awareness among the doctors as well as the parents on this particular disease. That is a bit, people usually put some dialogues on it, but still I feel that number of autism cases have been increasing, and the prevalence of ASD is 6 per 1,000, with about 4 times as many as males as females. So it's very much common in males. So this is a old data. So the recent data of the Indian origin is not available as at present. So it could be even higher also. So the types of ASD, there are mainly the classification of ASD is, first one is autism. This is a major form, and it forms the core of ASD. Okay, whenever we talk about the ASD, major of the times we talk about the autism. And second type of ASD is Asperger syndrome, is the closest to autism in science. But unlike autism, people with Asperger syndrome have no significant delay in language development. So in autism, you will find a significant language development, whereas in Asperger syndrome, there is no delay in the language development and they will be very much vocal. So as you have seen in the film, my name is Khan. Okay. Even apart from that, you have got plenty other serials available. Say, for example, the recent one is called as the Good Doctor. Okay. So that's also is quite good on depicting these autism related issues. Okay. The third one is pervasive developmental disorder, not otherwise specified, also called as in short form PDD-NOS, sometimes called atypical autism, is diagnosed when the criteria are not for a more specific disorder. Okay, some consider Rett syndrome is very much common. It's a hereditary disease, a genetic disease, not hereditary, it's a genetic disease, and only found only in females. And the typical feature is that the female child will have a short head or microcephaly, we'll call us. Okay. And childhood disintegrative disorder, which share several signs with autism, but may have unrelated causes. Coming to the causes are widespread, and the hereditary, first about the hereditary causes, autism has a strong genetic basis. Although the genetics of autism are complex and are at unclear till now. Okay. But still, they say that there is a strong genetic basis, because, say, in the twins, they suggest that 0.07 number of autism cases are quite high, as high as 0.9 for ASD. In siblings, also about 25 times more likely that if the child can be autistic in among siblings than the general population. Even the people with the language and cognitive abnormalities, if found in the relatives of the autistic children or among the parents or siblings. Okay. they will suffer from autism. Chromosomal abnormalities like Fragile X syndrome also common in the families of autism. And even there is a condition called as increased paternal age. So if the father's age is above around 40 plus, then the incidence of autism is even quite high. Okay. Then coming to the biological causes, that we have divided into prenatal, natal, likewise. So prenatal factors like intrauterine rubella, then tuberous sclerosis, chromosomal abnormality like Fragile X syndrome, brain anomalies like such as hydrocephalus, all are the possible causes for autism. Postnatal, we have got something called as phenylketonuria, infantile spasms, herpes simplex, meningitis, encephalitis, even some of the different mutations, they usually occur. Okay. And that's like the evidence is the synaptic dysfunction, also considered to be the cause for autism. And all known teratogenic agents, okay, that cause the birth defects related to the risk of autism appear to act during the first 8 weeks of conception. So it is not coming exactly under postnatal cause, but these birth defects usually is found. Okay, nowadays with the scanning and all, you'll find it, but some of them usually are missed. Okay, so they are also considered to be, to say, can these teratogenic agents are considered to be the some of the causes for autism. Okay, and you can add it under the prenatal or the natal causes, prenatal causes, sorry. Next one is about the environment factors. Major of the people describe this as the major factor for, major causative factor for autism. That is infectious diseases or certain type of foods. So based on this, we have this GFCF diet has been evolved. Heavy meal solvents, diesel exhaust, PCBs, then phenols used in the plastic products like plastic products, then pesticides, brominated flame retardants, alcohol, smoking, illicit drugs, vaccines also. MMR vaccine has been given a major etiological push in earlier days, and stress even by the child as well as during pregnancy. Okay, and autism symptoms results from maturation related changes in various systems of the brain also. So this MMR vaccine, and one more is the leaky gut theory. Okay, so that's also given a prime importance, especially from Ayurvedic side, we can talk much about it. Coming to the symptoms, symptoms gradually begin after the age of 6 months and become established by 2 to 3 years. So that's very important, after the age of 6 months and established by 2 to 3 years and continue through adulthood. Okay, as I have told, the three pillars, that is the impairment in the social interaction, impairment in the communication, and restriction, restricted interest, and repetitive behavior. Okay, so we will see one by one. The impairment in the social interaction. So the ones which are highlighted, you just keep it in mind. That will be more than enough for you to get the points. Okay, so have social impairments and often lack intuition about others. So what they usually do is that they will take people for granted. Okay, they won't mind that their parent is sitting or somebody stranger has come. They won't mind at all. Okay, autistic infants show less attention to any kind of stimuli, like social stimuli, smile. So when you look at to him and smile, he will not smile back, or and look at others less often and respond less to their own name. So you call his name, they won't usually respond. They show abnormal social play, lack of empathy, inability to make friends, then very narrow interest and preoccupation with the parts of the body. So altogether, what we can say is that their social interaction itself is impaired. And if you talk about the autistic toddlers, what they will have is that, strikingly, these features you can find, they will have a less eye contact. So that is the basic identification, you can say. Whenever you talk to somebody, usually they will look into your face, is it not? So that itself will not be there. That is the less eye contact and turn taking. More likely to communicate by manipulating another person's hand. So the parents usually come and say that, so whenever he wants some item like chocolate or something above the fridge, he will not show that they want that particular item with their finger. Instead, he will take the parent's finger and he will show that item he wants. and child is withdrawn and often spends hours in solitary play. So that is very, very crucial, solitary play. That means he likes to play alone. He doesn't mingle with his friends or peer group. Okay. And they will have difficulty in spontaneously imitating and responding to emotions. Okay. Or to how to communicate non-verbally. So their body language itself is entirely different. Next, coming into the impairments in the communication, this is the main second core of symptoms. About a third to a half of the individuals with autism does not develop enough natural speech. Okay, so the speech is not developed naturally, or you can say yes, their natural speech has not been developed. So if at all it has been developed, it will be abnormal. So the differences in communication may be present from the first year of life, or may include delayed onset of babbling. So you know the milestones of speech development. Okay, so delayed onset of babbling, unusual gestures, diminished responsiveness, vocal patterns that are not synchronized with the caregiver. So that is very, very important. So the vocal pattern. So we have got something called as when a normal child or when a normal person speaks, there is something called as the modulation of the sound, is it not? So in the second and third years, autistic children have less frequent and less diverse babbling, consonants, words, or word combinations, and their gestures are less often integrated with the words. Okay, so if at all you make these children to share their experiences, they likely to simply repeat others' words. So you ask him, what is your name? So he will repeat the same sentence or the same word. If at all he repeats the same word, we will usually call it the echolalia. It is going on repeating, amma, 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 amma. So likewise, okay. Or there is possibility of a reverse pronounces also. And most notable symptoms are poorly developed verbal and non-verbal communications, okay, which I was explaining, and visual scanning of the hand and finger movements. So whenever somebody is speaking, so they will do is the visual scanning of the hand and finger movements. Mouthing of objects, rubbing of surfaces may indicate a heightened awareness and sensitivity. So a particular kind of toy is there, a fur toy is there. So he'll like to rub it major of the time. Okay. Or the child will not like to sit on a particular type of chair. Okay. Or doesn't like to wear a particular type of dress. Okay. Or diminished response also can be formed, particularly to the pain. And then lack of startle response to sudden loud noises. Okay, so that will show their lowered sensitivity to other stimuli. So heightened awareness and the lowered awareness or sensitivity, both could be formed. Then approximately 75% of the children with autism are mentally retarded. Okay, and their cognitive levels are significantly associated with severity of the autistic symptoms. Apart from this, there are a particular group of people which we usually call as autistic savants. So we will talk about in the next slides. So the third point is repetitive or restricted behavior, that is stereotypy, that is a repetitive movement such as hand flapping. So it'll be like to move these hands constantly, or if at all he gets one pen or something like that, he will like to make it like this all the time. That is making sounds, head rolling or body racking, or the rotating items they will usually like the fan or the tire of a toy of the car. Compulsive behavior is intended and appears to follow rules such as arranging the object in stacks or lines. If he's having a particular toy, he likes to arrange it in a particular way. Okay, that we usually call as the sameness. Okay, for example, insisting the furniture not to be moved. Okay, refusing to be interrupted. So if at all that is being done, the tantrums will develop. So he will get angry. Okay. And ritualistic behavior. So that is an unvarying pattern of daily activities. Okay. He doesn't want to change his menu. He doesn't want to change his dressing ritual. Okay. So sameness. He likes to only one kind of dress. If you change, he will not like. He likes only one type of toy. That in a particular way he want to play. Restricted behavior, which is limited in focus, interest, and activity, such as preoccupation with single television program or toy or a game. Then possibility of a self-injury includes movements that injure other person or such as eye poking, skin picking, hand biting, and head banging, or he will injure himself. So mainly, the commonest we will find is self-injury, okay, where he will injure himself, like hand biting, a particular finger he may be biting or hand. So in that particular area, you'll find that the marks of a continuous injury. Okay, children with autism do not engage in pretend play. That's also very important and a normal developmental pattern. So that will not be formed. And this is about the autistic savants, which I was talking about. That is, an estimated 0.5 to 10% of individuals with ASD show unusual abilities that ranges from sphincter skills, such as memorization of a trivia, that is a quiz, etc., to extraordinary rare talents. Okay, so they usually excel. I think you would have heard about the swimmer from China. I forgot his name. So he was a autistic child. Okay, but he was very good in swimming. Okay, so he reached that very top. So likewise, if you search, you will find some are very good in music, some are very good in writing stories, or some particular skills which they are very good. So that is very limited percentage of people are showing such kind of skills, but still it is considered to be a gift. Okay, so we'll usually call them as autistic savants. And many individuals show the skills in the perception and attention relative to the general population, and 60 to 80% of the people will have poor muscle tone, poor motor planning, and toe walking. So that also can be observed. Atypical eating behaviors, and then 1/5 to 1/3 of the children will suffer from epilepsy. And the diagnosis is very, very important. So how we will diagnose? About half of the parents of the children with ASD notice that the child's unusual behaviors by around 18 months, which I was talking about, and about 4/5 noticed by 24 months. Okay, so major of the times what happens is that the first child, if the new parents, which we will usually call, so if they are very much busy with their work and all, so what happens is that they tend to postpone treatment. Okay, so they will come even on a later phase or later time. But usually, if at all you take the history, that by this time they would have noticed that my child is not like the other child, okay, or especially of the peer group or the second child. Okay, so what they need to do is that they have to bring the child for the specialist, okay, where we will usually advise we will ask these main symptoms, whether the child has had any babbling. Okay, so that is not found till 12 months. No gesturing, that is pointing or waving goodbye, by 12 months. No single words by 16 months. And no two-word spontaneous phrases by 24 months. Any loss of language or social skill at any age. Okay, that is, we call as the regression of the milestones. Okay, so he would have developed the language, or he would have gone through a particular phase where he is able to tell a story, and then he will gradually regress. Okay, so for these, we can advise the DSM-4 criteria, which is very much easier for you to read. For the exam, that would be more than sufficient. Nowadays, DSM-5 has also come, and the criteria is as exhibiting at least 6 symptoms of the total DSM, okay, criteria, that is Diagnostic Statistical Manual. Okay, including 2 symptoms from the qualitative impairment in the social interaction, 1 symptom from the qualitative impairment in the communication, 1 symptom from the restricted and repetitive behavior is a must. Okay, so 2, 1, 1. So total you will have a minimum 6 symptoms, or more than 6, obviously you will have. Okay, apart from this, if the child is in there is one more called as MCHAT form. I think the slide is missing. MCHAT, MCHAT. Okay, so that also can be used. Form is readily available in the internet. So that also can be used, and it should be given to the parents. So that will they have to tick the typical signs or the symptoms which the particular child is showing, and based on the particular number of score, we can identify that whether the child is possible autistic or not. So what will be the outcome of the treatment we have given? Okay. So early accurate diagnosis of extreme importance, as early intervention is crucial. And no drug or other treatment cures the autism. So that is the very, very important information that you need to give. But don't give that information on the first hand whenever you diagnose the parent of a child with autism. But instead, we have got plenty to do in those children. Okay. So the main goal is about lessen the associated deficits and family distress, and to increase the quality of life. The quality of life you can improve, and the functional independence. Okay. So functional independence on the parents. Okay. So that can be easily done. How? That we will discuss. So the second point what you can do is that intensive sustained special education programs and behavioral therapy that will very much will be useful in children to acquire self-care, social and job skills, and will help to improve and decrease the symptoms, which are very much severe, and maladaptive behaviors, it will decrease and should be started before the age of 3 years. That is very, very crucial, because the child is on a growing phase, is it not? On a particular milestone, he will be going on achieving. So in that particular time, if at all you are able to manipulate, so the outcome is very much good. Third, you can start with the therapies like speech and language therapy or special education, parent education, different types of training. And some of the doctors advise pharmacotherapy also. And social skills therapy, occupational therapy, all these are having its own importance. Apart from this, even music therapy also is very much useful. Okay. So the most successful educational model at present is that from the allopathy system, we will call as the treatment education of autistic related communication handicapped children, TEACCH, TEACH. And some of the doctors advise heavy metal chelation, especially in the Arab countries, they usually do. Then GFCF diet is also being advised, that is gluten-free, there is a small mistake, gluten-free, casein-free diet. Okay, so the gluten-containing item and casein-containing item are to be skipped from the food. Gluten-containing item, all the Godhi items, okay. So, and casein, milk and milk products mainly. The prognosis is mainly, say when we talk about the children, especially with speech delay, okay. So they are not having a much, no speech are not having a much good prognosis compared to a person with a little speech or good speech. Better prognosis is associated with higher intelligence, functional speech and bizarre symptoms and behavior, okay. And the symptoms often changes, it will not be same, okay, depending on different age group, it will change. And as the children grow older, and sometimes the seizures and self-injurious behavior also becomes more common as the child advances in age. Coming to the Ayurvedic point of view, this is being compared with the Unmada Roga and autism spectrum disorder simulate with Unmada Roga, okay, due to its genetic and the congenital causes. Hence, the treatment principles of Unmada are very much useful in ASD. So I hope since Unmada has been dealt to you in detail in Charaka Samhita and in Roganidana, so I'll not be going to talk much about the classical references on the Nidana, Samprapti, Lakshana, all those things. But I'll give you some guideline on how and why Unmada is, or what treatment aspect of the Unmada can be taken for is autism, okay, ASD, okay. So you know this Kala Artha Karmanam Yoga, Hinamatyati Matraka, okay. So these all the Indriyas, Indriyarthas and Manas is having a very much crucial role in perceiving and in learning about the social skills or about the different language or speech or about the behavioral aspects, is it not? So all that may get impaired in case of Unmada. So that we usually tell in these names. That is the definition of Unmada, is it not? Manovibrama, Buddhi Vibrama, Samya Vibrama, Smriti Vibrama, Bhakti Vibrama, Shila Vibrama, Chesta Vibrama, okay, then Acharya Vibrama. So all these are typically go in hand with these ASD. Okay. And the treatment aspect from the ASD, for the ASD can be taken up from the Unmala. Practically, you can adopt all these Purakarmas like Snehana, Snehapana, Shiropichu, then the Panchakarmas like Mrudu, Sneha, Shodhanas, Niruha, and Snehavasti, Nasya, and Anjana. All these are depending on the age of the child. Okay, Nasya is not very much ideal for 3 years. Okay. Pratimarsha can be done. Shamanas line of management like Shirodhara can be done, where we can do Takradhara or Tailadhara also. Okay, based on the dosha involved. Takra Shirolepa. Then the from the Unmala Chikisa itself, we have got the Sattva Vajaya treatment, that is we call as the psychotherapy. Under that we have got Bandhana, then Tamogriha Rodana, Tarjana, Trasana, Dana, Harshana, Santana, Vismaya, and the Yavapasraya like Sarpipana, Pradeha, Utsadana, Abhyanga, Dhuma, Mantra, all these could be adopted, but depending on the age of the child, depending on the condition of the child, and depending on the perception of the parent. Okay. Practically, we will find that when we assess the child with autism, he will have a Agni-related complaint. Okay. He will have a Kosha-related complaint. So, which we have already discussed about the gut leak theory. Okay. Maybe in theoretical classes, they would have discussed, so I will not go in much detail. And there is something called as brain-gut axis. Okay. So, that's the area where Ayurveda is having a much role, where Vasti is having considered to be the Ardha Chikisa. Okay. So Vasti is even very much helpful for the brain related disorders like Pakshagata and other things, is it not? So this is a 1 hour or more we can talk on this, but I will not, since it's a exam oriented, I will not go in detail about it. But practically, we can adopt this integrated approach. Under that, the medical management we can plan, and the other therapies like speech therapy, psychotherapy, behavioral therapy, occupation therapy, so you can take the help from those therapists. Medical management is stepwise planning of the treatment. So first of all, you need to identify which type of dosha has been affected in the child. So if you say kapha dominant, so you open up the kapha janmada, you will find that the child is much more sedentary, you will not be liking to play with anybody, you will like to sit, or is very much tamo dosha, aggravation you can find. Okay. So pittaja, there will be very much aggressive. In vataja, there will be much of cheshtata will be there. Or a combined of these taratama vedas can also be done, or the combination also can be formed. Based on that, you have to plan the treatment. So agni kosha correction. So that is the first line of management usually we adopt. That is pachana and deepana and vata and lomana of medicines. And then we can plan for the Unmadhara treatment as Shodhana and Shamana. And at last, we can plan for the Medhya Rasayana type of medicines. Okay. Along with this, you have to maintain the Patya. In the form of Patya, of course, from the Ayurvedic side, we can incorporate the GFCF diet as well as the particular dosha, Prakopakara Aharas and Viharas need to be avoided. So that itself is a Patya. So clinically, some of the effective therapies like the Lehana is like Vilva, Panchanga can be used, ST Madhu can be used, Tippali, ST, Draksha can be used, and from the Kashaya, Draksha Samangadi, Draksha Madhukadi, Balakanka Patradi, or even simple Drakshadi Kashaya is very much useful, Shatavari Chinnaruha Kashaya, and from the Grita, is we have what this Brahmi Grita. Much more useful on pitta dominant conditions. Kalyana Grita, Mahakalyana Grita will be useful on vata dominant conditions. Tiktaka in pitta dominant, Jivantyadi Grita, and even Panchagavya Grita, which very much useful in kapha dominant conditions. Then Murdalaya Pass, it's Bala Sohaladi from Arugya Kartabruma. That's also very much useful. My own friend during my PG time has done a thesis on this. That's also very much useful. The treatment package, you can say that you can identify a autism child, and if the parents are willing, you can plan the treatment on your hospital setup for a, say 12 days or 14 days or 21 days, and then you advise him some medicine at home for 3 to 6 months. That we call as the inter package, that you can advise shamanic drugs. So in between, whenever they get admitted, you can plan these areas. But I am not saying that you have to do each and every step. But depending on the, I have just given some examples, depending on the stage of the dosha and stage of the child, avasthana sarena chikitsa, is it not? So you can advise these medicines. Shiropichu vatashina taila can be done. Sneha pana kalyanaka tikta kirta. Kashayas like drakshadi or mudrikadi, abhyanga, shirodhara with vatashini or danundra taila, niruha, dvipancha muladi or matravasti with mahasneha or danundra taila or kshirabala taila, nasya with kachura dishuna. Then internally at that time we can advise manasamitra vataka, even takradhara in some conditions, shirolepa in conditions. Okay. Where we do shirolepa, we will not advise shiropichu at the same time. Okay. I hope all these ideas you are already having. So this is about the nature of the treatment about the ASD. Okay. Next, coming into the ADHD, that is the attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD. So it's a bit different from the ASD. So here there is attention deficit is there, but the hyperactivity is the crucial. So this is a syndrome first described by Heinrich Hoff in 1854. The poor ability to attend a task. So he's having a difficulty to attend a particular task. There is a motoric overactivity and impulsivity. So these three conditions you can find in a patient of ADHD. The onset occurs before the age of 7 years, and a large majority of the patients exhibits by 4th year of age. So if you take the history by 4th year itself, they will have this issue. So how we will identify? Most of the time, the parents would have identified. If they have missed, the nursery school teacher would complain to the parent that the child is not sitting in one place, is not following the command words being given by the teacher. You ask him to sit and do one particular task, he will not do. Before that, he will do the activities like he is running on a motor. Okay, that is what we call as the motoric overactivity, and he is very much impulsive. So the characterized by age inappropriate hyperactivity, impulsiveness, and inattention. So these three are very crucial. Please note it down. The classification is classified into three classes. One is all the three symptoms. This is the majority. Second, the first two symptoms, that is hyperactivity and impulsiveness, will be found. Third is mainly three symptoms, that is inattention is relatively uncommon. Okay, so based on these, we have got three classes. And hyperactivity is usually the first symptom to be noticed. It's about the example of a teacher I was giving. Okay. Etiology, it is more likely to be a biological factor than a purely psychological one. So there is a biological factor is playing a major role. So many factors like the following have been incriminated. That is minimal brain damage, and there is something called as the maturation lag. So the proper maturation is not happening. Genetic factors are at play. Neurotransmitter level is having some issues, or early developmental psychodynamic factors also are having some play. Coming to the epidemiology, prevalence is, if you take and go into a school and take the 100 children, you'll find that around 3 to 5 children are having these issues. And it's also, unlike ASD, more common in boys than girls. Initial identification of many children with ADHD commonly occurs when they enter the nursery or elementary school. Okay, so that example I have already given. The children are often reported as being disruptive and unresponsive to directions. They often provoke others to anger and do not seem to learn from the negative consequences of their behavior. So that is very, very crucial. Okay, so the parent is being told by the teacher that, say, whenever the parent gives some negative consequences for the particular behavior, Okay. For example, the child has shown a particular behavior. He was very much impulsive. Then he gave some. He has been awarded some punishment. So, usually a normal child will try to avoid it on, say, on the second time or third time or fourth time, whenever the punishment is being given. But these children will not learn from the negative consequences of their behavior. Okay. This again is diagnosed with the help of DSM-4 criteria. Among that, the inattentiveness is manifested when the child often makes careless mistakes, failing to give close attention, often does not seem to listen, often does not follow through on task. So they have, if the child is being given task one after the other, will have difficulty in following it. Often have difficulty in getting organized. Okay, maybe it may be related with the school books, or maybe with the dress or with the toys or anything. Okay, often dislikes or avoids sustained mental efforts. Often loses things. So that is very, very important. You give the pencil, or you are having this particular book, or a tie, or a shoelace, or such other things, or ID card. So all those things the child tend to lose very often. Often gets easily distracted. Often is forgetful. Okay. And as per the DSM-4, hyperactivity is evidence when a child often fidgets. I hope you know about fidgets. Often is out of his or her seat. So that is very much impulsive. Okay. He doesn't want to sit there. Quiet for say 5 minutes or 10 minutes, not even 1 minute. Runs and climbs excessively. Often has difficulty in playing quietly. Is always on the go, as though driven by a motor. Often talks excessively. Even over talking is also considered to be a hyperactive scenario. Next is about the impulsivity. It is reflected in a child who often blurts out answers before the question is even asked. So what is your name? Name is not being told by the teacher. Name or the first alphabet comes itself, we will blurt out with the answer. Okay. Often has difficulty in awaiting his or her turn. So if you are in a queue, they will have very difficulty in awaiting. Okay. Often interrupts or intrudes on others. Okay. So the diagnosis of ADHD requires the presence of at least 6 manifestations from the inattentiveness cluster and 6 from the hyperactivity impulsivity cluster, or both. Okay. Differential diagnosis for this ADHD: pervasive developmental disorder, schizophrenia, mood disorders, mental retardation and learning disabilities. And often ADHD can be associated with other diseases like mild mental retardation or lead poisoning, tic disorders, learning disabilities, iron deficiency anemia, thyrotoxicosis, etc. Okay. So the laboratory studies are not having much role on CT scan or MRI or EEG. Okay. And lead toxicity, iron deficiency anemia, thyroid abnormalities should be ruled out. So this is the points which need to be ruled out. So in these, you can find these conditions like of hyperactivity or inattentiveness with other things. Okay. And behavioral questionnaire is the accepted instrument for documenting the symptoms. So behavioral questionnaire is available. So that could be used for documenting the symptom. The course is about, or the prognosis we'll say, about 80% of the patients improve on their own by the time of puberty. So of course, you can advise the Ayurvedic management also. From the allopathy side, pharmacotherapies are used. They are especially the stimulant type of medications. And they usually advise some behavioral modification, that is behavioral therapy. And counseling and supportive psychotherapy also is advised. As from the Ayurvedic side, if you think that we will find that they are typically suffering from a Vata Pitta dominant condition. Vata Pitta dosha involvement is, or Prakopa has can be documented. And that shamanal management can be adopted very easily. and definitely you are having a good outcome in ADHD conditions. So again, it's compared or simulates with the Unmada. So Unmada line of management, whichever we have discussed in the earlier slides, definitely can be advised. And from the Shodhana, like Mrudu Virechana, Vasti, or Smanduka Parni, Kshiranasya, or Shodhana can be advised. Brahmana line of management is very much useful. Snehana for the head, that itself will give you much result, like applying oil, okay, Shiro Abhyanga, Tunga Drumadi Taila, Chandanadi Taila, Himasagara Taila, okay. Internally, Medhya Rasayanas like Shankavishpi Churna, or Shamana drugs like Mahabhaishati Grita, Kalyana Grita, or the other Gritas which we have already discussed earlier. So with that, I'll come up with the end of the session, and I hope I have taken a little more time than what has been expected of me, and I am sorry for it. And if at all you are having any doubts, you can take it up. Otherwise, whatever, we will move on to the next session, I hope. Ma'am.
Thank you so much, sir, for very informative session on Chayamutra, autism and ADHD. Yeah. No need to ask sorry, sir, as the topics are too much, definitely it will take time.
Yeah, okay.
The thing is that just I want to cover more topics for the students. That's why I have clubbed it.
Okay. Yeah.
It's very good, very informative, very nice session by sir. Now the topic is open for question. Okay. If any questions from the participant side, they can ask the questions. No questions are there, sir.
Okay.
If any questions are there, we will take at the end of the session.
Okay.
Now, just we'll move on to the next session. Okay. As we have one more session today by Dr. Ajay Chauhan, sir. Now, I call Ajay Chauhan, sir.
Yeah, thank you, ma'am. Thank you for...
thank you so much, sir.
Audience, as well as for giving me the opportunity.
Definitely, sir. Definitely. Thank you so much for sharing your knowledge with us for students. Thank you so much, sir. If any questions are there, we will take at the end, sir.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Please be with us, sir.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Now we'll move on to the next session. Our next speaker is Dr. Ajay Chauhan, sir. Sir has completed UG from Bharati Vidyapeeth College of Ayurveda, Pune, Maharashtra, and completed Kumarabhrutya PG from the SDM College of Ayurveda Hassan, and presently working as Associate Professor and Head of the Department, Kumarabhrutya at MES Mahavidyalaya, Ratnagiri, Maharashtra. Sir is having 10 years of teaching experience, and sir also holds post-graduation in hospital management course. And sir has participated in many seminars and presented 10 scientific papers in many national and international platforms. Today, sir is going to deliver a session on breath holding spells, pica, and all other behavioral disorders. Now, I'll hand over the session to sir. Sir, over to you, sir. Ajay, sir.
Yes. Screen is visible.
Hello, sir.
Yes, it is visible. The screen is because here my yes, attend.
It's not visible now.
Okay. Sir, I will close it and again I will open.
Sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Once again, you share the screen, sir. Hello. Sir, are you able to share the screen, sir?
Yes, it is audible.
Yes, sir, it is audible.
So should I share the screen now?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. सर शेयर नहीं हो रहा है सर वो
हाँ वन मिनट
हाँ सर हाँ आया
ओके
सर
ओके सो सॉरी फॉर द डिले
नो प्रॉब्लम सर नो
फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल लेट मी थैंक डॉक्टर सरिता एंड आयुर्वेद महाविद्यालय हुबली फॉर गिविंग मी दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी टू डिस्कस ऑन this particular topic. The topic given to me is behavioral disorders in children. So behavioral disorders are due to change in the behavior. And most common causes are frustration of the child, fright, or the anger. And the involuntary activities occur as a tension discharging phenomenon, and it results into these disorders. And most of these are variations of the normal behavior. When they interfere with the child's own or social functioning, intervention becomes necessary. Then we will see the causes of behavioral disorders. They are learned by imitation of the adults. Mostly they are imitations of the adults, and body manipulation begins as a way of discharging stress or tension. Sometimes the child is in stress or tension, and due to that, the body manipulation, the child does the various body manipulations, begins as a purposeful movement, but later on it will be out of control of the child. And different body movements to attract the attention of parents or caregivers can also be practiced by the child. And due to the feeling of insecurity or being neglected, the behavioral disorders, they take place. Then we will see the examples of behavioral disorders. They are bed wetting, as discussed by the Keshava sir. Then breath holding spells, temper tantrums, pica, encopresis, thumb sucking, nail biting, hair pulling, or it is also called trichotillomania, teeth grinding, that is bruxism, head banging, tics, and stammering. So out of these, I am going to cover only the red one, the breath holding spell, temper tantrums, pica, and all. The others are already discussed by the other expertise. Now, as per the, I have classified these according to the behavioral change. They are breath holding spell and temper tantrums are the disorders, and habits forming are thumb sucking, nail biting, and also the teeth grinding, bruxism. As you see, these are very small topics in the syllabus, but in day-to-day practice, general pediatric practice, many patients you will see with these habit disorders. The parents usually complain of thumb sucking, nail biting, and temper tantrums. Breath holding spell is also common in the in-office practice. And starting from the breath holding spells, breath holding spell occasionally occur during a tantrum. See, temper tantrum is a different disorder, but breath holding spell can occasionally occur after a tantrum or during a tantrum. Usually age of presentation is 6 months to 3 years of age, and younger infants are least affected. What are breath holding spells? These are reflective events in which the crying child becomes apneic, pale, or cyanotic. Then it may lose consciousness also. Occasionally, we'll have a brief seizure episode. Without a reinforcement, it generally disappears. There are three types. Actually, it is three types: cyanotic breath holding spell, pallid, and the combination of the two, that is mixed. And coming to the cyanotic breath holding spells, it is a dominant type. Most of the cases we see is the cyanotic type. Even gets precipitated by the frustration of the child. The child starts crying and stops breathing with his mouth open without taking the next inspiration. Also called as this noiseless crying. Child becomes blue and may become flaccid, non-responding, or develop seizure. And hence the child becomes blue, and hence it is called as the cyanotic breath holding spell. There may be tonic posturing or a few clonic jerks, and then he recovers spontaneously and rapidly. How to differentiate a seizure disorder from a breath holding spell is it needs a good history taking. And in case of seizure disorder, you will see no frustrating factor for the child or the event, no aggressive cry before a seizure, no breath holding spell before a seizure, and cyanosis occurs after the seizure. The very important point to be noted here is cyanosis occurs after the seizure, whereas in breath holding spell or cyanotic breath holding spell, cyanosis occurs first and later on it leads to seizure. It may or may not lead to seizure in a breath holding spell. Frequency of attacks vary from 1 to 2 per year or many per day. In extreme conditions, the child may suffer from many attacks in a day. And here the point is EEG is normal in breath holding spell. Treatment: counseling the parents to avoid situations that can precipitate the event. Counseling about benign nature of the disease. This disease is totally benign, and you don't have to worry about this. Anoxia, that is brief in this case, will not cause any damage, and those children later do not develop any seizure disorder. The child should not be spoiled by conceding his every unreasonable demand. Or here oral ion therapy can also be initiated. iron in a dose of 2 to 5 mg per kg per day for 1 or 2 months can be tried. And most of the children, they respond to this oral iron therapy. A sharp pinch at the start of the wide open cry will change the nature of the cry, leading to frequent inspirations thereon. In retractable cases, oral diazepam can be tried for a few months, but it should be practiced very safely because diazepam, you know, is a sedative and spells remit by 3 to 5 years of age. Then coming to pallid breath holding spell, we have seen the cyanotic type. Then the pallid, here the child becomes pale after the breath holding spell, and hence it is called as pallid, also called as pallid breath holding spell or pallid infantile syncope. Here initiating event is pain or the fright. Child respond to pain by sudden apnea followed by loss of consciousness and tone. And in occasionally it leads to seizure. The child appears pale, hence it is called pallid. The episode resembles a vasovagal syncope. Vasovagal syncope, what it does, there is malfunctioning of the particular part of the nervous system which controls the heart rate as well as the blood pressure. Here in vasovagal syncope, there is unconsciousness followed by the child becomes pale. Hence, it resembles the pallid breath holding spell. But the differentiating point between the vasovagal syncope is it is a initiating event is present in case of breath holding spell. It can be differentiated from tonic seizure by the initiating event. Treatment here is the make the child supine. It is also a benign condition. No drugs required. Usually abates by the age of 5 years of age. Iron therapy may be given. No attempt should be made to terminate the episode by inflicting the pain. And atropine can be tried in intractable or too frequent episodes. Atropine can be tried. Later on, I will demonstrate a video on the breath holding spell because the network is slow and hence I'm avoiding right now. Then coming to pica. As the picture suggests, the child is eating mud or the clay or a sand. Habit of eating non-edible substances like plaster, charcoal, clay, wool, ashes, earth, stones, chalk, paint, etc. It can be a part of normal exploration of the environment in infancy. Also called as oral phase, you know all that oral phase do exist in infancy period where at the time of teeth eruption, the child takes everything in the mouth which comes to his hand. It is called as oral phase. So hence, in infancy, it should not be considered as abnormal. It is normal in case of oral phase, but it is not abnormal beyond that. Isolated habits like nail biting, etc. should not be considered as pica. And definite etiology here is not known yet. Few cases may be due to mental retardation, poor parental supervision, or iron deficiency. Some complications of pica include worm infestation because of frequent eating of the clay, etc. items. And as you know, the clay contains the poisonous metal like lead, and which accumulates in the body of the child, leading to lead poisoning. And both are due to the dirt that child eats. Treatment of pica. Here, deworming can be tried with albendazole. Albendazole, the dose is below 2 years, 200 mg, and followed by 200 mg on the next week. Then the parental palmoate, 11 mg per kg per day for 2 consecutive days can be tried. And iron supplementation by observing peripheral smear. Peripheral smear, if it shows RBC morphology as hypochromic microcytic, then we are definite that iron deficiency anemia is there, and you have to start the iron supplementation in the form of 2 to 5 mg per kg per day for 1 or 2 months. Then supervision by caretaker to discourage the child from eating the non-edible substances, and find time to play with the child which can deviate his attention away from this habit. Then coming to temper tantrums. Again, temper tantrum is an aggressive outburst. So previously we have seen the breath holding spell can be a result of temper tantrum also. Usually occurs in a toddler who cannot control his frustration. Its demands are conceded. After a tantrum, it gets reinforced. It becomes habit to the child, habitual temper tantrums. The child uses this trick repeatedly to get his demands conceded. The child is very clever than his parents, and uses repetitive use of this trick to fulfill his demands in the form of temper tantrums. Parents or professionals should evaluate if there is reason for anxiety or depression of the child. And best management here is to take a neutral response by ignoring the tantrum without punishing the child. Just leave the child alone, giving him an opportunity to recover. Let him understand that demands cannot be considered by tantrums. So here, psychological therapy should be tried. Any demand which the parents consider as reasonable is best fulfilled before a tantrum. And here, note that adults should not become bad role models by their own aggressive outbursts. So first of all, the adults in the house should control their own aggressive outbursts. And coming to encopresis, that is also called as soiling. Encopresis is persistent and inappropriate passage of liquid or solid motion in children above 4 years of age in the absence of organic pathology. This is the definition of encopresis. Involuntary soiling during diarrhea is not encopresis. Two types are there, primary as well as secondary. Primary, the child had always been soiling, like in case of enuresis, the primary enuresis and the secondary enuresis. Here also encopresis, it is two types. Primary, the child had always been soiling, and secondary occurs after a period of continence, that is secondary encopresis. There are other two types, retentive encopresis, mostly due to the chronic constipation or fecal impaction. Liquid stool leak out around the hard stool. It is retentive because the stool are retained. The stool, they retain in the large bowel. Non-retentive encopresis, it is rare, and inappropriate soiling without evidence of fecal constipation and retention. It is non-retentive. Soiling accompanied by daily bowel movements that are normal in size and consistency. Treatment here is patient education. Relief of infection by enema can be tried. Stool softening medications or laxatives, as they can be used as maintenance. Here, many laxatives are used, polyethylene glycol, lactulose, and prolonged use of stimulants like bisacodyl should be avoided. Diet, high fiber diet enriched with fruits, vegetables, and whole grains. That is, balanced diet should be given, and adequate intake of water daily is encouraged. Regular exercises for a elder child, toilet training by the parents, psychotherapy. Caregivers should be instructed not to respond to soiling with retaliatory or punitive measures, likely to become angry, ashamed, and resistant to intervention. The child becomes angry because of the inappropriate approach towards the child. Cases where behavioral or psychiatric problems are evident, psychologists should be consulted, and parents should reward the child for adherence to the healthy bowel regimen. For children with chronic diarrhea or IBS, stress, IBS is irritable bowel syndrome. Stress and anxiety play major role here in the child, and stress reduction should be done, and learning effective coping strategies can also be tried. Here, relaxation training can be given, stress inoculation, assertiveness training is adopted, and general stress management procedures can also be tried. Help of behavioral health specialist is considered. Habits. So in previous classification, I have highlighted habits as nail biting, thumb sucking, and the bruxism. So these are the three habit disorders. Involve an action or pattern of behavior that is repeated oftenly. It is common in childhood. Range from benign and transient behavior, that is thumb sucking, nail biting, this is benign conditions, to more problematic like trichotillomania and bruxism. These are problematic, or these are not benign. Do not cause clinically significant distress or impairment in the functioning. Thumb sucking and nail biting, those features are highlighted here. Thumb sucking and nail biting, common in first 5 years of life. Beyond 5 years, it may be associated with sequelae like paronychia, anterior open bite, and self-soothing. It is self-soothing to the child, and intervention may be considered in children more than 4 to 5 years who suck their fingers in multiple settings. The treatment here is managing the stress of the child, reinforcement, that is praise and reward for not thumb sucking. You should praise the child for not thumb sucking, and reward can also be given so that the child do not become habitual particular disorder. Application of an aversive test substance to the thumbnail. Here I have highlighted in today's era, the lotion that is available is Femite lotion. And physical barriers like thumb screens can also be given. Now the coming to the teeth grinding, that is bruxism. We have already, many of us may be knowing the teeth grinding or may grind their teeth as well. Bruxism, it is common in childhood, also common in the adults, may occur in 5 to 30% of the children, and non-purposive teeth grinding, usually at night, it is bruxism, can begin in first 5 years of life, may be associated with daytime anxiety. So this is an anxiety disorder. Later on, it becomes habitual. It may be an expression of suppressed anger or physical discomfort. Previously, it was attributed to abdominal discomfort due to worm infestation, but it is not so. It may cause local pain and teeth malalignment will be there due to the constant grinding of the teeth at the night. Persistent bruxism can lead to muscular or temporomandibular joint pain. And untreated bruxism can cause problems with dental occlusion. Treatment here is muscle relaxant before bedtime for a short period in some cases will help. Botox injections, it is a form of botulinum toxin in cases of severe bruxism who don't respond to other treatments, and medications for relieving anxiety or stress. Bedtime can be made more relaxing by reading or talking with the child and allowing the child to discuss fears. And persistent bruxism, use of mouth guard can also be tried. Here, emotional support to the child should be given and praise the child on good behavior. There is another video for bruxism of the child. Let us watch later. And here I have highlighted the normal teeth and the bruxism or the teeth grinding. There will be aberrations or the decay in the enamel of the teeth. Here in the next picture, we are seeing the splint which is given by the dentist to the particular patient. Thank you all. So these are basically, we have seen 4 to 5 conditions which are very common in pediatric practice, but the as per the syllabus point of view, it comes mostly for the short notes and for 3 or 5 marks. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, for very short and very nice information. Now the session is open for discussion. Participants can ask the questions from first session also and from second session also if anybody have any doubts. Sir, what is meant by epispadiasis? Why they have asked this, I don't know. What? But some PhD students, they have asked.
What is meant by?
Epispadiasis.
Epispadiasis is nothing to do with this particular topic.
That's only I am telling. Why they have asked, I don't know. But they have asked in this session.
This is a abnormality of the penis. Actually,
abnormal opening of the urethra.
Yes.
It's not related to this topic, but it is an abnormal opening of urethra. That's what we can say.
I will try to play the video 1 minute.
Yes, sir. Definitely. Sir.
This Google Chrome is visible over there.
It's not coming here, sir. It's not visible here.
Yes. It's not visible.
You just click on once again, sir, on that.
1 minute. See here, you can note down this link and you can watch the video on Google Chrome or YouTube, so that you will come to know about the breath holding spell, how the child reacts. And the secondly, bruxism video is also there. The students can make make a note of this link.
Yes, sir. I think
there are limitations in Zoom platform. Two screens cannot be shared at a time.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. I think they'll take the screenshot of this. Later on, they can visit the YouTube.
Yeah. Take a screenshot. And another bruxism video.
There. Just show another one also, sir.
Yes. So this is the link for bruxism video. It's okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I think there are no questions from the participant side. Once again, I thank both the speakers of today's Prasanna sir and Ajay sir for a very nice session. And thank you so much for spending the time with us and sharing the knowledge to the students. And there is one more question, sir. How to differentiate between the bruxism caused by worm infestation and a day anger?
Bruxism caused by?
Bruxism caused by the worm infestation and because of anger, how you differentiate?
No, because this is the bruxism is a result of frustration or the anger. The worm infestation and or whatever may be the reason, the symptoms shown by in the bruxism are the same. Are you getting?
Yes, sir. But this bruxism is the same, but other like worm infestation, other symptoms are also there.
Yes.
That may be the differentiate between the worm infestation.
Worm infestation, and there may be itching at the anal region at night or abdominal pain associated. But coming speaking about the bruxism itself, there are no such two types like bruxism caused by the worm infestation and the bruxism which is caused by the anger or the frustration.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. That one same question. As epispidiasis is mentioned as one of the cause in primary aneurysis, so that's why he has asked. Keshav, sir. Maybe the students wants to know that how the epispidiasis is caused for the aneurysis. Hello, Keshav, sir.
Keshav sir might have gone near left, I think.
Sir, he is there, sir. He is there in the meeting. Just now he has unmuted. He'll answer, I think. Keshav sir? Yes, sir. As epispidiasis is a cause for primary aneurysis, how? That was maybe the question by the student. That's why he has raised that topic. Epispidiasis means what? Hello, Prasanna sir. Prasanna sir, you are not audible, sir. Prasanna sir. as it's epispadiasis is a structural deformity, that may be the reason for a primary aneurysis, because child will not able to completely empty the bladder. That may be the reason. When I don't know the exact reason why the epispadiasis causes the primary. Sir has came.
Hello.
Hello, sir.
There is some connectivity issue.
I'm
using mobile at present. So the thing is that what I was saying is, see, this is a congenital malformation, which would be found along with some other congenital malformation also. So it's an anatomical deformity. So that could be one of the reason why there is a possibility of a primary aneurysis, where the toilet training or the dryness would not have been attained by 5 years.
Yes, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah.
Yes, there are no further questions from both the topics. Once again, I thank you both. To both the speakers from our Ayurveda Mahavidyalaya Hubballi and from the Komara department, sharing their knowledge with the students. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I'll end the session. Thank you once again.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.